हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग टू एवरीवन। टुडे लेट अस डिस्कस अबाउट लेक्चर टू ऑन इलेक्ट्रिक हीटिंग। माय नेम इज मंटेजा। आई एम असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ट्रिपली बीवीसी इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज ओडलरेवु। इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट फॉलोइंग टॉपिक्स: इलेक्ट्रिक आर्क हीटिंग प्रिंसिपल, टाइप्स ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिक आर्क फर्नेस, डायरेक्ट इलेक्ट्रिक आर्क फर्नेस, इनडायरेक्ट इलेक्ट्रिक आर्क फर्नेस, एडवांटेजेस एंड डिसएडवांटेजेस ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिक आर्क फर्नेस, डायलेक्ट्रिक हीटिंग प्रिंसिपल, डायलेक्ट्रिक हीटिंग, एडवांटेजेस एंड डिसएडवांटेजेस ऑफ डायलेक्ट्रिक हीटिंग, एप्लीकेशंस ऑफ डायलेक्ट्रिक हीटिंग। सो व्हाइल वी डिस्कस अबाउट इलेक्ट्रिक आर्क हीटिंग, the arc furnaces depend upon the principle of heat generated by electric arc. The electric arc heating may be used in the following different ways. So there are mainly two ways: by striking the arc between the charge and electrode, by striking the arc between two electrodes. So first method, by striking the arc between charge and electrode. Here in this method, the heat is directly conducted and taken by the charge. The furnaces operating on this principle are known as direct arc furnaces. These furnaces are used for production and refining of various grades of steel. So the second method is by striking the arc between two electrodes. In this method, the heat is transferred to the charge by radiations. The furnace operating on this principle are known as indirect arc furnaces. These types of furnaces are used for melting of non-ferrous metals such as brass, copper, zinc. So while we come to the types of arc furnaces, there are mainly two types of arc furnaces, namely one is direct arc furnace, second one is indirect arc furnace. So if you want to discuss about the first type of arc furnaces, that is direct arc furnace, so here is the figure. So we have observed that inside a furnace there is some charge placed at the bottom, and also some electrodes are deep inside the charge, but these electrodes are not deep inside into the charge, so there is a small gap in between the electrodes and charge. If you observe, we have dipped three electrodes, so we are using three phase supply here. And also here the furnace is grounded to avoid the short circuit like that. So we can say that this is a direct arc furnace. Here we can clearly observe there is some gap in between the charge and electrode. So the gap in between the charge and electrode, the arc is struck. So the gap in between this charge and electrode, so there is, the medium is ionized. So whenever the arc is struck between the gap between charge and electrode, some heat is produced and that heat is transferred to the charge, and so the required so the charge is finally heated by the arc. So while we come to the explanation, the above diagram shows a direct arc furnace. The chamber of the furnace is linked with refractory material. The arc is struck between the electrode and charge. Three electrodes made of carbon or graphite are projected from top of the furnace, and three phase supply is given. The current passes through them via the charge. Since the arc is in direct contact with the charge, it is possible to produce highest temperature by direct arc electric arc furnace. As the arc passes through the charge, it will produce automatic stirring action. So again, the arc produced in between the gap between charge and electrode has a negative resistance characteristics, that is resistance fall with increase in temperature. Thus some current limiting device is used in the circuit to prevent short circuits. It may be in the form of reactor. Direct arc furnace is very commonly used for production of steel. So in this method we can clearly say that the heat produced from the arc is directly excited to the charge without any another medium. So here this method is called as direct arc heating or direct arc furnace method. We'll come to the second method, which is indirect electric arc furnace here, which is different from the first method. Here the heat is transferred to the charge indirectly, not directly. If you observe here in this indirect arc furnace, there is again one furnace is there and charge is placed at the bottom, and two electrodes are placed here, but these two electrodes are not in contact with the charge. Again there is some gap in between these two electrodes. Again we know that here arc is stuck in between the gap between the electrodes. You can say that here whenever again the medium between these two electrodes is ionized, whenever we apply some AC supply or DC supply in between the two electrodes, then arc is struck. The struck arc has some which generates some heat. This heat travels in between the medium of furnace and then it gets excited to the charge. So here we can say that heat is not directly transferred to the charge. It is transferred to from medium which is of which is in between the inside the furnace. So this is called as indirect arc furnace. While you came to the explanation, the figure shows that an indirect arc furnace. In this furnace, the arc is formed between two electrodes and heat is so produced is transferred to the charge by radiation principle. So the temperature is lower than direct arc furnace. So indirect arc furnace are suitable for melting metals having lower melting points, non-ferrous metals such as brass, copper, zinc. The arc is stuck between the electrodes, so only two electrodes are required. The supply here used is generally a single phase supply. So during the process of heating, electrodes are consumed. So feeding of electrode to the indirect arc furnace is automatic. The furnace is here used is in cylindrical shape. Since the arc does not come in contact with the charge, so automatic steering action which is present inside the direct arc furnace is optional. The furnace may be equipped with automatic rocking equipment. Power factor varies from 0.7 to 0.8. The electrode material and electrical equipment of the indirect arc furnace are similar to that of direct arc furnace. So here in this method, the arc is indirectly transferred. So indirectly transferred to the charge means heat is indirectly transferred to the charge in indirect arc furnace method. While you come to the advantages of electric arc furnace, these are very these have maintenance. These are very least expensive and does not emit any dangerous emissions. Well, you came to the disadvantages of electric arc furnace. Electric arc furnaces are very expensive to repair. While they are very least to purchase, but the repairing cost of electric arc furnace is expensive. Also, it takes running cost of electric arc furnace for every month is more. And electric arc furnaces are not very efficient or less energy efficient at heating large spaces. While compared to other methods. So next one topic is dielectric heating principle. Dielectric heating is also called as radio frequency heating or electronic heating. When a non-metallic material such as wood, plastic, bone or ceramic is subjected to an alternating electrostatic field, there is some dielectric loss occur in it. This loss appear in the form of heat in dielectric heating. It is the basic dielectric heating principle. So while we come to the dielectric heating method, here we can have clearly observe that there are two figures. In the first figure there are two electrodes and a DC supply is applied between them. So we can clearly observe that between two electrodes there are some ionized charge. In the second figure we observe again there are some two electrodes, between them again some DC supply is applied, but between the two electrodes if we place a dielectric material and apply the supply between the two electrodes, then finally we will get some dielectric loss, and this loss is used for heating the required material. While you came to the explanation of dielectric material, and dielectric material has positively and negatively charged ions. If we place such material between two electrodes and charge them positive negative respectively, molecules will tend up to line up all in one direction. If we reverse the charge on the electrodes, then they will tend to flip around and line up in the opposite direction, reversing the charge across the molecule to rub against one another. This process produces frictional heating in the material. The rate of heating will increase as the frequency of reversal is increased. The same phenomena takes place in a material during dielectric heating. When we apply a high frequency voltage across a material during the dielectric heating, its molecules line up again and again. In doing so, they rub against one another and produce frictional heating. As the frequency of reversal of the field, that is supply frequency, is very high, a large amount of heat is produced. Advantages of dielectric heating. Since the heat is produced through the whole mass of material, we get a uniform heating. By the conventional methods of heating, it is not possible. So here we can say that uniform heating is possible through dielectric method. A shorter time is required to complete the process as compared to other methods. Here the time required is very, very small. It is suitable for non-conducting materials. Means non-conducting materials can be heated by using dielectric heating, like wood, plastic and synthetic compound. The next one is disadvantages of electric heating. Since the heat produced in dielectric heating very much depends upon the type of material, the product size and power density, etc. So we can heat only these materials which have a very high dielectric loss. It is not possible to heat a transparent or reflective material by this method. The cost of equipment used for dielectric heating is so that we use this method only where their other methods are impactfully or too slow. The overall efficiency of dielectric heating is very low, about 50%. High efficiencies may cause radio interference. So when we came to the application of dielectric heating, it is used for drying textiles, manufacturing of plywood, paper, etc. The overall efficiency in this case of dielectric heating is about 50%. It is also employed for drying tobacco, water, tobacco, paper, wood, gluing and bonding of woods. It is used to weld PVC. It is used in producing artificial fibers, heating of bones and tissues. It is used in food processing. In high temperature dielectric heating applications, we can combine it with other conventional heating methods like resistance heating or hot air heating.